गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ शुभा लक्ष्मी एंड टुडे येट अनदर टॉपिक वी हैव ब्रॉट इन सेलिब्रेशन ऑफ नेशनल मातृ वेयर वी हैव बीन कवरिंग डिफरेंट टॉपिक्स एवरी डे. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट हाउ टू स्टडी मॉथ लाइफ हिस्ट्रीज एंड हाउ टू लर्न टू रेड द मॉथ कैटरपिलर्स. So if this is a topic of your interest, I suggest you can join in. It's going to be a short session. So just giving basic tips on how to rear a moth caterpillar. So let us know from where you are joining. And if you have any questions, please drop it in the message box, in the comment box. I will respond to it. So I'll just wait for a while to get more people joining. So thank you. Just give me a moment. People who have joined, please let me know from where you are joining us, and a bit about your interest in the subject, that will be really helpful. And if you have already done moth life histories, so please share your experiences here for benefit of others. So I'm going to begin the topic. While others join gradually, let me know if I'm audible enough and whether you're able to see my slides progressing. I will pause here for a while. Yeah, anybody watching can tell me. I'm able to see myself also, but it'll be good if you can tell me if you're able to hear me clearly. Okay friends, I think I'll move on. Maybe someone will just prompt in. Okay, so moth caterpillars are like rearing a moth caterpillar is almost similar to rearing a butterfly caterpillar. And why moth caterpillars are to be studied? One is that there is not enough data in our country especially about moth life histories. So it is very common nowadays for people to take a picture of a caterpillar wherever they are found. Maybe sometimes they find a caterpillar inside their homes, sometimes they find a caterpillar in the balcony, sometimes on the garden floor, or sometimes on the road actually. So people keep taking such pictures from very odd locations other than plants. Okay, plants is a natural set up for a caterpillar, but when people keep sending me these pictures and then they expect that I should be answering that which moth is going to come out of it, now that becomes a challenge for me because I personally haven't read many caterpillars of several families. I have done extensive caterpillar rearing of two families for sure, that is hawk moths and emperor moths, and then on and off other families, but not very rigorous caterpillar rearing are done. And that's where we feel that everybody can actually contribute by rearing at least one or two caterpillars which they find in their own locality. So the data is very sparse, I would say. So it's not easy for any experts to give a ready-made answer saying that this caterpillar will turn into this moth. So we haven't reached to that stage. In order to reach to that stage, we need more and more people to start documenting moths. Now, as you know that this is part of National Moth Week celebrations, and during this time, it is expected that we put up the light sheets and observe moths and photograph moths. Well, that could be a challenge for someone who has never done a mothing session. But rearing a caterpillar comes very easy, because this is one activity which even students can do. Students can be involved. So, because you normally get to see more of moth caterpillars. In fact, when the monsoon season begins, that's when you see more of the moth caterpillars compared to butterfly caterpillars. Now, what are moth caterpillars and what are butterfly caterpillars? We'll speak about it in later part. But I'm just asserting the reason that why we are emphasizing more on it. And knowing a moth, the entire life history, sometimes helps us to manage a species also. As you would know that a large number of moth caterpillars are also fall in the category of pests. So many of the pest species are already like well documented, but I'm talking about wild species, like for example the mangrove moths. The mangrove moths come in large numbers and eat away the mangroves, and during that time the entire mangroves are like, you know, defoliated completely. Now, if one, as a forest management practices, if such kind of outbreaks have to be managed, so if we know the life history, that how long the caterpillar stage will last and what impact it has in the host plant, which are the other host plants, so all this inside information about the moth is available, then it becomes very easy for managers to even manage a situation. So I'm just giving an example. So let's understand some basics of life histories, and the basic is simple, as students who have studied in the textbooks, that there is an egg, and out of the egg comes out the caterpillar, and then the caterpillar changes into a structure, like a structure called pupa or also called chrysalis, and then that matures into a butterfly. That's usually the life cycle of a butterfly. But if it is a moth, there is a slight twist in it, and the twist comes at the pupal stage. So instead of just going out on a leaf or on a twig and just pupating in open, just like the way butterflies do it, moths do a bit differently. Or the moths use a shield to cover their pupa, and that cover is called cocoon. So you would have known, like in schools, it is mentioned about the moth, the silk moth cocoon. So that is a popular example which everybody knows. Yeah. So most of the moths make cocoon. So this is one additional feature in the moth life history. And both butterflies and moths are known to undergo a process of development which is called complete metamorphosis. It means that the juveniles do not resemble the parents. If you have seen a cockroach, a baby cockroach, tiny cockroaches, because that's the closest example I can give. So you would see that there are tiny cockroaches. In fact, that's how they proliferate in our homes, that the babies actually have been sent through the drain holes inside our homes, you know, just like spies. And these babies then grow up into adult cockroaches. So it's not the adult cockroaches coming in, it's usually the babies who actually are sent inside in your homes. So the baby cockroach grows into an adult cockroach. So the baby cockroach and the adult can be compared, and you can make out that they look similar. The only difference would be the wings are not present in the juvenile form. But in case of complete, so that kind of development phase is called as incomplete metamorphosis, which does not have a stage called pupal stage. There is no standstill in the life process for them. Like their life just keeps on moving, they just keep on growing. So there is no time that they are going to stop eating and just suspend themselves. But in complete metamorphosis, the groups or the insects which undergo that, they suspend their metabolism in the pupal stage, because then there is no more feeding. Whatever has been eaten in the caterpillar stage is used up to form the body organs of an adult insect. Now, juvenile forms of different insects have different names. Caterpillar is an exclusive name given for the babies of butterflies and moths. Now, so that's about the life the basics of incomplete and complete metamorphosis, you need not remember all this. You only just remember that if you see a baby cockroach, it is a baby cockroach. But if you see a small cockroach, it could be a baby cockroach. But if you see a small butterfly, it is not a baby butterfly. It is an adult, because the juvenile doesn't look like the caterpillar doesn't look like the butterfly or a moth. So let's start from the egg stage of the moths. So I'm trying to draw similarities from butterflies because they are more well known and people would have encountered them more often. So therefore I'm trying to draw parallels from there. So in butterflies, they lay eggs singly, that is one egg at a time, and sometimes they lay eggs in cluster also, like in one line, three batches, something like that. Yeah. So moths also do the similar way. Moths also do lay eggs singly as well as in batches. But beyond that, they are also doing something extra. What is that? They can make towers, like the column. There's a column of like here you can see this column. So this column, so there could be columns of eggs stacked on one on each other, and sometimes the eggs could be just laid and covered with the body hair. Here this moth name is Mathura moth. It's a tussock moth, that is a group name, and the body hair has irritating properties. It is very hairy, I would say. So when the eggs are laid, eggs are like a bunch of something like this. You can see the spike, something like that. A bunch of that, maybe 300 to 400 eggs are laid, and those eggs are then covered with a body hair. So the eggs are given extra protection. Now this is something additional what moths do, which butterflies don't. I think in butterflies, butterflies probably don't need this kind of protection as moths would be needing, because if you try to see in the on the evolution path, the moths came first and the butterflies came later on. So what the moths couldn't figure out, I think the butterflies already figured it out. So that's the reason butterflies have become more simpler, easy to understand them. They can be like, they could be very predictable, but in case of moths, it's still the complex is there, still the systems have been not formed there properly. It's like that. So it's still a chaos state, and that chaos is what is causing trouble for moths, because that's the reason people are not really, you know, getting into moths or learning them more often, because too many complications are there. So eggs are laid in different styles. This is what I was mentioning. Now there is also some moths who lay eggs in clusters, and the one who lays singly. There's a difference is that in moths there are two types of adults. One is that one group in certain groups, the adults don't feed. They are fasting moths, we call them. And in another group, it's a feeding moths. So they feed on nectar. So their lifespan is longer, whereas the ones who have shorter, who do not feed and have shorter lifespan, so they don't have to waste their time in laying single eggs. So what they do, they just lay all the eggs in one go, and then just that's it. They die thereafter. So in these moths, the eggs are already ready in the body. It's just when they get mated, so the eggs get fertilized and the eggs are ready to, like they are fertile and they could hatch it. Whereas in the moths who are feeding moths, the eggs are forming as and when the eggs are laid. So therefore the lifespan is also longer, and that the eggs are laid in single form, and these eggs then are laid mostly on upper side of the leaf or underside of the leaf or on a tender shoot of a branch. Now these are the areas where one can look for eggs also. If you know a host plant, so these are the places where one can see. But these moths who lay eggs in clusters, not necessarily that they are going to lay eggs on a particular plant. They might lay eggs on a bark, on a stone, wherever, you know, but not necessarily on a host plant. this group of, so this means that the caterpillars could be polyphagous. Polyphagous means they are eating more than one type of plant as a host plant. So what are the host plants and what are the nectar plants? So host plants are the ones on which the moth chooses to lay egg, and the baby, that is a caterpillar, is going to feed on that, on the same plant. And nectar plant is a plant from where the adults, who are feeding adults, they take nectar from the flowers of it. So these are two set of plants which moths are going to use. Now how loyal they are to this host plant, like how choosy they are about this host plant, that is what decides. Now species which are only feeding on tree species, on tree categories, they are mostly taken as, like, considered as indicator species, because their presence will tell that these tree species are existing, and because the tree species are there, therefore they are there. And having a trees, like, trees are the indicators of any forest area rather than herbs and shrubs. So that's how the host plants plays an important role. And also that group of moths will also have first preference, second preference, third preference, or more options will be there. So there will be some range of plants which the caterpillar would be feeding, but there could be some most preferred one. For example, the tussar silk moth, it is found in the most of the Indian cities. It is invariably found on the Ziziphus plant, that is a bear, the wild bear, which is an edible fruit, you know. So that, on that plant, we normally, the caterpillar, the cocoons will be always found. But at the same time, the other plant, you know, the wild almond, that is Terminalia catapa, on that plant also one can see the caterpillars of tussar silk moth. So that becomes a second. So there are options. So if you are wearing moth caterpillars, if you get to know these options, it is sometimes very useful. And at the end of my presentation, I'll be mentioning about from where are the resources where you can actually we can get this kind of data. Okay. Good, I'm seeing people have started responding. Thank you very much. Okay, I'll just take one question from Gaurav, who says, butterflies lose lot of eggs due to environmental changes or to ants, wasps, do moths also? So yes, it is the problems of butterflies face, it is same for moths also. That's the reason they lay large number of eggs. When I said 300 to 400 eggs are laid, so not necessarily everything. So the dangers, everything remains the same. It is just the method what the moths are even using is like more laborative, more laborious, I would say, because there are more efforts that goes into it. So eggs, when the eggs are laid, the color is usually could be pale white or green, light green, or whitish or yellowish. But when the caterpillar starts developing, then you start seeing the caterpillar inside the egg. Now you were wondering that how big the egg is and how big this baby would be that I can see it. Okay, the egg size will be starting from I think to the one, at least I can tell you about hawk moths, from 3 mm, you know, from 3 mm to the emperor moths, like the tussar silk moth egg. Tussar silk moth eggs look almost like millets, you know, like the jawar. Jawar size or the millet size, that size variation is there. So that much, that could be that big. I think those are the largest eggs of in moths, because they are emperor moths and they have the largest egg. So usually it could be up to 5 mm also. So that's the size. And when you get to, if you pick up an egg for life history studies, so you will come to know if the eggs are going to hatch, because the color changes and it darkens. If it darkens, where you can see that the outer shell has become very transparent and you can see a dark speck inside, usually the head is always the darker part in the body. The caterpillar body is very translucent, but the head is darker. So if you see that, then it means that the caterpillar is hatching. But if you see completely black and no, you know, you can't see the transparent cover or you can't see the other part, then be sure that the eggs are either parasitized or the eggs have gone, or sometimes you'll also see that the eggs have shrunken. And this happens in moths who lay eggs without mating. So this also happens in moths, that they will lay the eggs even if they are not mated, because as I said, the time is very less. These are non-feeding moths, they have less time on hand, so they have to finish the job. It's just like finishing a task. So they might lay the eggs which might be infertile also, and then these eggs can shrink. So that means that there will be no caterpillars hatching out of it. So if you are if you have not tried rearing a caterpillar, don't start from the egg stage, start from the caterpillar stage only, because you will have less challenges. And once you are once you get confident of rearing the caterpillars from the caterpillar stage, then you can actually go a step down and start from the eggs, because that needs a bit of more care. I think the care, what is it? One is that unless you're not very sure, don't pick up any caterpillar or egg, because it's a responsibility. Because if you're picking up a caterpillar and if you're not able to provide its food on time and the caterpillar dies for this, then that's a complete loss. So only pick up these insects if you're confident that you're going to tend them. Okay, so if you happen to come across the egg, eggs on the plant, I would suggest that just take that branch, don't nip off the tip where the eggs are there, take that entire branch and keep it in a water bottle, just put it in a plastic bag or something with some holes here it, so that there's a breathing happens of the plant and that it is protected, the egg is protected, and you can see in case the caterpillar hatches and it doesn't fall into the water. So I usually secure it with a plastic bag with a rubber band at the base and then put it in the water bottle, and then you can keep on observing if the eggs have hatched, and when you see that it has hatched, then you can transfer it into a caterpillar rearing jar, like which is like any plastic container you can. So if you are able to witness this, that the moth, that the caterpillar hatching from the egg, then you would also observe one behavior, that the caterpillar feeds, the first meal of the caterpillar is the eggshell. That is a meal. Like in Atlas moth, they will not feed on the plant, they will first feed on the eggshell, and they will all undergo the first molt. So caterpillars, both butterflies and moths, they undergo 5 stages in the growing phase as a caterpillar, which are called instars, and every instar is marked by shedding a skin. So it's like the baby is growing and the clothes are not fitting in, so the skin is shed at 5 times. So 5 times they have to shed the skin and they enter into this 5 instars. So first time it is first instar, and then the second instar, and so on. So instar is just a technical term, you need not remember, but you can remember this part, that they shed the skin as they keep on growing, because their skin is not stretchable like ours. Our skin is stretchable, so it doesn't matter, but for them it is like a insects, you know, insects where there is skeleton outside, so they have the bony structure, tougher structure outside the body, so that doesn't expand, so therefore they have to shed the molt. So they start from the eggshell as a meal, and so in the Atlas moth, which I was telling, that after the first molt, then they start feeding on the host plant. So if you have the host plant, that is from wherever you have collected the caterpillar, if you happen to pick up a caterpillar, then collect the host plants also. Now, how to collect the host plants? Try to take leafy branches, don't take single leaf. The single leaf will dry away very soon, and you can take branches just the way we get this coriander and kadi patta in market, you know, the entire brand. You can keep them fresh in the fridge for very long time, right, if you keep them with the twigs. Similarly, you can bring these also in a leafy manner and go for like if it is a small, like of course you mean if you haven't tried this before, you may not really know that this caterpillar is really small or it has grown big, because what you may be thinking small, maybe not small, because that might be a smaller moth caterpillar only and it will not grow further. But I'm just saying, in case if you know, so younger moth caterpillars prefer tender leaves, and the older as the caterpillars grows bigger, they prefer mature leaves. So all in all, so best choice will be try to take branches which are having some tender leaves and mature leaves, and take that entire branch, put it in a Ziploc bag and keep in your vegetable tray in the refrigerator. The leaves can remain, if it is in an airtight condition, it can remain fresh for at least 1 week. So 1 week, if it is not a caterpillar from your garden, you need not do this. But if you're going somewhere and you came across a caterpillar, then you can very well collect this way, and then before the resource gets used up, you go and try to refill it. So host plant plays a very important role. So that's from there you start. So you should have, if you have a caterpillar, you should be having a host plant, then only pick up. If you don't have a host plant with you, I would suggest don't pick up the caterpillar. So there are different stages, as I mentioned, the five instars where the caterpillar molds. But what else happens in caterpillars? Caterpillars change. This is not true for all species, but I'm just saying in general, some caterpillars change body color. They don't change body color like overnight thing. Suppose the caterpillar is due for a molting, say it is a third instar caterpillar, third time molt it is happening. The fourth, after the caterpillar has molted, after the skin has been shed, what you see is instead of a green caterpillar, you see a brown caterpillar. So this is triggered by the change in the microclimate. This microclimate could be change in the humidity level, temperatures. This is a small world of the caterpillar. Anything changes, it tries to change. Now darker colors are associated with drier seasons, but I have seen in the forest, I saw that the green form and the brown form same on a same plant during the monsoon time also. So there could be other reasons of this, but I'm just saying that we should, so don't get you should not think, oh, this is a different species. No, they might be, they just, the color is different, but they could be the same species. So what is it? They can change the color, they can change the shapes also. Like hawkmoth caterpillar, there is a hawkmoth caterpillar called Marumba. So Marumba so all hawkmoth caterpillars have a horn on the tail end. That is the identification of a hawkmoth caterpillar. But this Marumba, when it has hatched from the egg, that time it is just having one single horn at the tail end. But when it enters the second or third instar, you suddenly see that it is coming out with another horn on the head region also. So then it is having two horns, one on the head and one on the tail. And then as it crosses the fourth instar, by the time it reaches the fifth instar, the head horn is gone. We don't know really the purpose of all this. Maybe the horns in this caterpillars is indicating, you know, camouflage in the plant where they are feeding. Because if you look at hawkmoth caterpillars, they have counter shedding means the colors of the lower side of the body are lighter and the backside is darker. So if you try to see the caterpillar from underside, so against the sky you see it, you can't really make out, because it is just merging. The leaf color is like lighter on the below side and darker on the top side. So it just having the counter shedding so that it gets camouflage. So that is how it just changed. So the horns also play a role. Like I've seen this in there is one plant, Carissa Karwanda, which is called locally. So it is having horns. So I have seen that the Karwanda hawkmoth is just positioning itself along with the horns. It is like almost another horn on the stem. So it could be a defense technique, or it could be something to do with camouflage. But I am just saying that the caterpillars change forms also. The example which I am showing on the screen is the of a lobster caterpillar. This is called lobster because this is how the final stage caterpillar looks like, which is almost like a lobster. It doesn't look like a caterpillar body. But when it is in the earlier stages, you can see the change in color, change in the body structure. The head and the tail end is not, the head and tail end is trying to, it's like, you know, fooling. If you look at this caterpillar, you will feel that this is the head, whereas the head is here. So here, this is what, you know, like they are just trying to like protect themselves. And then the caterpillar goes under this color, sometimes this color, and finally this color. So this is a changes a caterpillar can undergo. and this is the pupa into which the caterpillar changes into it. And this is the cocoon. So this cocoon is been formed in a leaf, if in a leaf roll. So caterpillars of moth caterpillars are, I would say, what, you know, they are more, they have more options as far as their pupation behavior is concerned. So they can take soil as a medium to pupate inside. They can take a leaf litter. They can also just take a twig and secrete their own silk. Silk is present in a caterpillar's body in a form of silk. There are the salivary glands which are modified into silk glands, and the silk is stored inside the body in a liquid form. The moment that liquid comes in contact with in the air, and that is where it hardens and forms a thread. So that's how the silk formation happens. And so silk is a very important tool that a caterpillar has, what it uses for defense, it uses for pupation. Like you would have seen, sometimes the caterpillars are hanging right mid-air. How they are doing, how they are able to do so. So I always say that the caterpillar has a you know, its own inbuilt lift. At any point of time, if there is a danger on the branch where it is, and it immediately takes its own silk lift and comes down. And that's where you see that they are dangling in the air. And if the threat has passed, they might climb back again the same silk thread by eating it, because silk is nothing but a protein. So they will not waste that protein. They will eat back that same silk and go back to the same position. Sometimes the caterpillars want to come down for pupation purpose, so they are not going to take the long route of going to the main trunk of the tree and then climbing down. They say, hey, let me start my own lift and I'll just go down directly. So many of the hairy caterpillars in the monsoon time, they are dangling in the air, and if they by mistake land up behind your collar or your neck, that's where it becomes problematic. So one has to be really careful. And these caterpillars which you see, the hairy caterpillars which are dangling in the air, they are basically coming down for pupation purpose. Or if by mistake there is a bird which has disturbed them on the tree, so they are just coming down for protection. So when you are on the forest track, try to be more like, you know, think about like this mid-air. This insects will be seen in the mid-air also, and you have to just protect. So that's how the caterpillars undergo. Now here I want to show you, like if you try to look at this lobster caterpillar here. So there are three. Now you can't see the third pair. The first pair is here, second, third. So they have three pair of true legs, because the adult also has this legs, therefore it is called true legs. But they have this another pair of legs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is called sucker legs or false legs. And false legs are, why it is called false legs? Because these legs are absent in the adult form. But if you get to see a caterpillar more than 5 pair of legs, then be sure neither it is a butterfly, neither it is a moth. It is another group of insect called as sawflies. It is a wasp whose caterpillars, whose juveniles look like caterpillars. But you can make it out because they like, in fact, they will even demonstrate a moth-like behavior, like looping kind of behavior. They can curl up their bodies. But if you look at, they'll be having too many prolegs. Like they'll be having 6 or 7 pair of prolegs, and that is an indication that it is a sawfly caterpillar and not a moth or a butterfly caterpillar. So when the caterpillar starts feeding on the plant, on the host plant, so when you need to, as I said, you need to keep the supply fresh with you. On daily basis, you need to provide them the leaves. So you can't really say, okay, let them eat the kal ka khana pada hai, kha lenge, you know. So it's not like that, because if the leaves turn stale, the caterpillars will stop feeding. In forest or in nature, they keep on hopping from one branch to other branch for fresh leaves, you know. So if you don't give that kind of food for them, then they will stop feeding and it will affect the caterpillar's growth. So best is that try to give them daily fresh leaves. But one more thing you have to do is, just like, you know, if you have a cat or dog at your home, you have to keep on cleaning their poop also. So similarly for these caterpillars, there will be droppings which look like black pepper. They need to be cleared off. If it is a small baby, it will be like black dots, and as this baby starts growing, then the size increases from smaller to bigger, but larger one looks like a black pepper only. So you need to keep one tissue paper in the base of the jar so that you can collect all this dropping and you can change it. So this is a slightly, I would say, a daily job if you are having a caterpillar at your home. And when the caterpillar has, it feeds, and when it is grown sufficiently, then it has to get into the third stage of its life, that is called the pupal stage. That is when it has to make a cocoon for itself, or a protective shell for itself, where it can pupate inside. And this, as I mentioned, they have various ways of doing it, the mud, the leaf litter, or the silk, any of this. So when the caterpillar decides to get into a pupal stage, it stops feeding. In fact, caterpillar also stops feeding whenever it is trying to molt. So if you have a caterpillar which has been eating and then suddenly you feel that, oh, it has stopped, just wait for a day or two. If there is no movement, and caterpillar will be, it will be motionless, it so motionless that you will feel that it is dead. So don't bother about it. It is just that it is preparing itself for the mold. Maybe on the third day you will find that the brand new caterpillar is there, because it just shed the skin, and some moth caterpillars feed the molt also. And then when the moth is, after molting, it becomes a voracious feeder, then it will hog like anything, then again it will slow down. So this is a natural process for the caterpillar. So when it comes to the pupation phase, even that time the caterpillar stops feeding and it becomes restless, the body color changes, the body liquids are, you know, is oozing out, because the body is shrinking. So if you've seen this, like the Atlas moth, this is the largest moth, right? So the caterpillars are also huge, but the pupa is not that big. Why? Because the pupa is like a shrunken size. So the caterpillar body actually shrinks into a smaller size, maybe half or less than half, so that it can just form a pupa. And the size of the moth has nothing to do with the size of the pupa. Why? Because the wings don't take space in the pupal stage. The wings are like a wing, like the buds, like a balloon buds in the body. And when they come in air, then only this balloon just get inflated. So there is no space required for it. So the body liquid comes out. So when you see this kind of thing happening, then you know that it is time for the caterpillar to pupate, and you should change. Give the medium that caterpillar wants, and if you don't know, you provide all the three mediums. Best option will be that you keep one caterpillar rearing jar and keep one jar as a pupation jar. So whoever is pupating, just transfer into that department so that they will make their choices and they pupate. So silk, as I mentioned earlier, the silk is a very important resource that caterpillars have in making the protective shield for them. Some caterpillars try to hide away using the silk, like underground. They go underground so that nobody can see them. But some caterpillars are very bold and they can make such beautiful netted hammock. And this hammock is actually sometimes made using their own body hair also. So this intricate design, you know, it is like really amazing that a caterpillar doing all this. And here you can see that the pupa is reclining inside this hammock. So this cocoon is not doing the job of shielding the pupa or protecting the pupa. Why? Because this is actually a tiger moth caterpillar, which are known to have poisons in their body. They store the plant poisons in their body, and they become distasteful, and that distastefulness is passed on to the pupa, and from the pupa it passed on to the adult. Yeah, so they are brightly colored, you can see. So they want to communicate to their predators that they are distasteful and therefore they should be not disturbed. So therefore they have to come up in open like this and show off. Yeah, and some who are shielded, who don't want to get exposed, they are usually brown color. You can see brown and dark brown color, and they usually under some leaf litter or silk or mud. And when the time comes of an adult, so what really happens in the pupal stage? So in the pupal stage, the entire caterpillar body organs get dissolved into what you say, a developing into a liquid form, which later on forms tissues, body tissues and body organs. So all the caterpillar organs are gone, liquefied, and then new formation takes place of the adult moth. So that happens. Now when the time comes that the adult has developed itself and it is time for emerging from the pupa, so there are various ways of doing it. If the one who is underground, the pupa who is who has gone inside, that pupa will actually crawl back to the surface, and then the moth will break open the shell, the pupal shell, and come out of it. So isn't it fascinating that the pupa actually travels back, travels to the surface? If it is a silk cocoon, the moth has a chemical which it secretes, and that chemical dissolves the silk strands. And that is the precise reason that in sericulture industry, they don't allow the moths to emerge. They kill them in the cocoon stage, so that the single strand, the single fiber of silk which is there in making this entire cocoon, the one cocoon, like in tussar silk, it is almost a kilometer long. The thread is one that long. So that should not be cut into multiple pieces. Therefore, they kill the cocoon. So because they can have this chemical to dissolve it. And the one which is in the leaf litter, they don't have to really work too much. They have to just break open the shell, which is usually from the head region, and then the adult moth crawls out. So that is how the adult emergence happened. And the emergences usually happen early morning times or late evening times, which coincides with their timing. If you keep a moth during the daytime, it will really flutter badly in the jar and lose all its scales. So if you see that a moth has emerged morning time, try to keep it in some sheltered area, in some garden, under the under the leaf or on the bark or somewhere, so it can rest and then it can take flight. Keeping in the jar for after it has emerged is not a good idea, because it will just keep on fluttering and damage itself. And in the evening times, of course, you can just release them. And if it is both in moths, they do hibernation. Hibernation is known in egg stage, in caterpillar stage, as well as in adult stage. In all these three forms, they can actually caterpillar and pupa, yes. So they can actually suspend their metabolism. So if it is a pupa which is to emerge in somewhere, say, usually the pupal intervals change, pupal duration is somewhere dependent on the size of the moth. If it is a bigger moth, it will take 15 days to 1 month. If it is a smaller moth, it may take some a week or so. So that's how the duration is there. So if it is a hibernating pupa, it will wait for the favorable season to come in. And it may almost hibernate for almost one, like from this monsoon to next monsoon, it will hibernate. And the body organ formation only happens when it is nearing the pupation, the emergence time. So the moth body is not prepared beforehand. So many people like this is applicable for the tussar silk cocoons. I am told that in south, especially in Andhra, the pupae are consumed. And they said that there is a milky thing which they drink. So I was wondering how a pupa is having milky thing. It's just because the pupa is in that liquid, is still there in the body. The formation hasn't taken place. Formation happens when the emergence happens. So that's how the development happens. In case of eggs also, it's the same story. The eggs don't develop. The caterpillar doesn't develop. It remains in that position. In caterpillar stage, the caterpillar just suspends its all activities and it can bury itself in the soil and just remain there for months together. I know one caterpillar which was hibernating inside the mud for almost 9 months without feeding, without nothing. It didn't come out and it was just there. And later on, eventually when the season came, it pupated and then the adult emerged. So when the emergence time is there, that's when the moth will need more space. So don't try to rear the caterpillars in smaller jars. Start with a 1 kg jar. because even if the smaller caterpillars, there's ample space, ample room, it's airy, not too much of moisture is trapped inside it. So just keep it airy. So that if you have a bigger moth, so they have the wings to, the body fluid are pumped into the wings, and the wings have to expand, and that space should be there. If they don't get the space, so they remain, you know, handicapped throughout the life, and they just die off. So all moths who emerge, they usually come up with big bellies. Why the bellies are big? Oh, for two reasons. One is that the blood is loaded in the body that needs to be pumped into the wings, and also if it is a female, she's loaded with the eggs. Yeah, so but if it is like this moon moth, you see here the pictures of the body, maybe not this bulky ones, the blood is pumped into the wings, and in the wings, you know, the veins are the tubes, are the like nerves, the way it acts with the vessels, the blood vessels in our body are there. Similarly, the veins act as a blood vessel of the moth body. So that's why the blood is pumped, and that gives that stiffness to the wing, which helps the moth to fly. So that's basic knowledge you need to know to rear a moth caterpillar. So you have this entire background that what really is required and what all you should be you know, keeping track of. So now here's, now let's get into the protocol of rearing a caterpillar. So one is that all hairy caterpillars are moth caterpillars, but that doesn't say that all moth caterpillars are hairy. Okay, so one is, so I would suggest that if you don't know to differentiate between a butterfly and moth caterpillar, start rearing any caterpillar that you get to rear. I think you will, because the chances of you seeing a moth caterpillar, coming across a moth caterpillar, is much higher than coming across a butterfly caterpillar. So I would suggest you start off with any caterpillar that come off. But if you're a first timer, I would suggest don't try with the hairy caterpillars, because hairy caterpillars need a bit of more care, because they, a slight brush of their hair to your fingers or palm fingers will actually cause a bad irritation. So always collect a caterpillar from the plant. Don't collect a caterpillar who is crossing the road or going on the ground or on a wall it is climbing. No, that fellow is out for pupation. It is not really interested in feeding anymore. So don't disturb that fellow. Let him do what, because many people do this and then say, रस्ते से जा रहा था तो मैंने इसको पिक अप किया, अभी क्या खिलाऊँ इसको. I say, बाबा इसको कुछ खिलाना नहीं है. Then nothing that you have to feed him, because it was going, it knows the best what it needs. So it will go and find a pupation site. So always collect the caterpillar from the host plant. Before you collect the caterpillar from the host plant, just browse around on the same plant and see if you can see half-eaten leaves. Because half-eaten leaves are there, it means that this is a caterpillar who has been eating it. But if you don't find any half-eaten leaves, it means that the caterpillar has landed up there by mistake and it is on the way to go towards the host plant, and you just caught him in the transit. So don't take chances with a plant which where the leaves are not eaten, because most probably that will be the wrong plant. So leave such a plant, such a caterpillar. So if you know that caterpillar is been feeding, and many times the telltale signs is the droppings. The caterpillar droppings are usually seen on the ground, so that is another sign. Then it is guaranteed that if you find the plant above you and there is a caterpillar, it is the host plant, because the droppings are below. So collect from there and put them in a plastic jar. Take a plastic jar, clean plastic jar, any old plastic jar, but of course not any spicy. There's in a jar which have been used for storing spice, which has a pungent smell or something, don't use that. Take a clean jar where you store your pulses and cereals, all that. That kind of jar is okay. So, and just make some holes, holes to the lid and holes to the side, so that the aeration happens. As such, insects don't need too much of air, but some kind of air movement and is always helpful. It can keep off the mold, like especially the fungal infection, away. And as I mentioned earlier, keep a tissue paper at the base of it so that all the droppings can fall there and you can also see the droppings, and it also absorbs any moisture which is there in the container. because moisture also gives rise to viral infection in the caterpillars, and the caterpillars really die. This is one thing happens, like when you start rearing caterpillars, you start seeing your caterpillars succumbing to this infection. There is a bacterial infection, there is a viral infection, and caterpillars die due to that. So best is that you see that you can provide them the best ambience so that these infections are kept at bay, and try to rear single caterpillar in single jar. Don't try to overcrowd. In that case, what happens that if one caterpillar is infected, the other caterpillar also gets infected. And also, you have to protect this jar from the ants, because you're having, if you are rearing it inside your home, try to keep it close to window window side, so that the ambience is same, you know, the outer ambience and the jar ambience is almost same, and there's not much of variation in temperature and humidity. And to protect, so when you keep a caterpillar jar, I don't know how, but the ants come to know that you are rearing a caterpillar. So you will find ants have actually invaded your caterpillar jar, and some they eat away the caterpillar life. So to protect your jar from the caterpillar, from the ants, you can apply a petroleum jelly at the base of the jar, or keep the jar in a plate of water. So water acts as a barrier and the ants don't come. So that is just a protection for the caterpillars. And believe me, I have lost so many of my caterpillars because of ants and because of this thing, which was not really known to me at that point of time, but this becomes very handy. Keeping the jar clean, feeding the caterpillar on daily basis is very, very important. And how to collect data now. So I already mentioned that there are five instars, and the data that is required to understand, number one, on which plant the moth laid the egg. Number two, what is the egg looking like? What is the egg size? Approximately how many eggs? Now, if you have observed it, sometime you can actually see also that how many eggs are laid, especially if it is it's a moth who laid this all eggs in one cluster, then it very becomes very easy. But I'm just saying that will be the one. Then the third thing is that how many days it took for the eggs to hatch, that is the incubation period. Then when the caterpillar hatches out, how does the caterpillar look like? Does the caterpillar change in color, change the shape, how long it takes to grow big, and what was it the size when it was when it was a baby, and then it has grown sufficiently big, what is the big maturity size when it is about to go to pupation, and when it reaches the pupation time, on which day it went to pupation, how long it remained in the pupal form, how does the pupa look like, what is the medium that it used, what is the cocoon like, size of the cocoon, and then finally the moth, which moth came up, and then identifying the moth. So this is the whole life history of the moth. So this is the data that one has to gather, and this has a scientific value for it, because it is, as I said, this, there are gaps, and we need people to connect, we need fill this gap, so we have this full story of every species. So we have this we have a data sheet. I'll just bring you to that link where you can actually download this entire data sheet and maintain this information. Now just look at this picture. This is the same species, it's a hummingbird hawk moth, and I told you about the green and brown form. Here you can see one is green and one is brown. We don't know if it is a gender thing. In many moths, sexual dimorphism is there. Male caterpillars look differently from the female, even that happens. And here we don't know whether it is a male or female, but I have seen that they just have different color. And so just to show you this example, and look at the horn I was talking about. The horn is all at the tail end. So identifying hawk moth caterpillar is very easy because of this tail feature. This is the data sheet I was talking about. This is the entire information. You can actually keep the data with you. So here you go to this link on Berwyn Publishers in the resource section. There you can download this data sheet, where you can collect the data For the caterpillars, even the adult data sheet is there. So if you're doing mothing, where you're studying the adult moth, so how that information has to be collected, even that is there. So this kind of, if this is a very systematic way of collecting information. If you collect information in this manner, then it has a, you know, it is worthy of publishing a paper. You can publish paper. So you say you were able to study some 10 to 15 moth species, life histories, and then you have substantial data with you and you can actually publish a paper. Now, for you to be very confident that a moth caterpillar took, say, 15 days of time to complete its caterpillar stage, 12 days as a pupation stage, this duration, until unless you are not really rearing 4 to 5 same species caterpillars, then it is not valid, because there could be many human error factors are there. And again, season matters. If you rear a caterpillar in monsoon and you rear the other caterpillar of same species post monsoon, there is a difference in it. So is there a difference? So to validate your data, you need to have multiple data sets. So here, if you can see that I have created one, the code section is there. So since you don't know which species is there, so we start from C1. So whatever C1 information you have, keep on repeating. Every day you are taking the measurements, every day you are making observations, or whenever the caterpillar is pupating, shedding the skin, molting, collect this data. So you can have those many entries under the C1 category, and when you do the sort and do the analysis, it becomes the entire information pertaining to C1 caterpillar is available with you. So this becomes very handy. So if you're interested, this is only useful for people who are really, who really want to take up at a research level. So this is a way to go about. Otherwise, if you just want to casually rear a caterpillar and have the fun of seeing it, how it all happens, great, put it on Instagram, put it on Facebook, even that is okay, because we really want that data. But when you do collect the data in such a systematic form, it has a scientific value, and this data needs to be published. So there is a, if you want to know the host plants also, in fact, on the resource section, you will also find the host plants data available. These host plants are only related to the moth species which I have used in my book. So my book, close to 800 species are there. So for that, the host plants are there. But if you go to Natural History Museum website, there is a host, H-O-S-T, host, which is a database of the Lepidoptera world over. That database of host plants is there. Very exhaustive database is there. I have picked up the information from that site itself. So when, in fact, some of the studies which I have done, my data is also sitting there, because they use that information, the host plant information. So if you rear the information, you can share your data with Natural History Museum, and they'll put it up on the, you know, the global platform, so that every scientist or any citizen scientist will be, you know, your data will be useful. So that's about rearing the caterpillars. I thought I'll finish it faster, but sorry, it has taken almost an hour. Try to, if anybody is interested in taking up this as a, this is a season to do it. If you are interested in doing this caterpillar rearing and you need any help, you can directly contact us and write to us, and we'll be really happy to help you out. So that's pretty much I had to share tonight. And you can actually drop your questions. If you have any questions here, I'll try to answer. I don't see. Okay, anybody has questions, anything for me, so I can answer while I'm live, or I will answer whenever you post it, I'll reply in the comment section. So thank you, friends, and I really appreciate all those who have been regularly coming meeting us every evening online here. So thank you so much for repeatedly coming here. I hope these lectures are adding some value to you. Do leave your feedback here, that will be really helpful for us. And thank you so much, and happy National Moth Week once again.